morning, everyone. I'm going to give you a quick update here from Brother Danny. Brother Danny recently just went to the island of Negros there in the Philippines. He's went there a couple times in the last year, and I want to send you or read you a letter that he sent. He said, I want to send you a brief report on a recent follow-up of his trip to island of Negros, where he was there to strengthen the new converts as a result of a previous mystery expo. In this mystery expo, 12 ministers were baptized and are now sharing the message with their respective churches. This is the third meeting that I have went since in the last year, and I have already shared the prophet messenger to this age, and there seems to be no, on this trip he shared about a prophet coming in this age, and there was no problem at all because they were already hooked to the revelations of the word that they had heard. The next stage is the necessary follow-ups to the churches to help them present the message to their congregation. Please continue to pray and support us in this endeavor. And as always, if you have a desire to support Brother Danny, just on your missionary, on the tithe envelope, just write Brother Danny Del Mundo, and we'll make sure this money gets to him to support with further follow-up to this island. He also said that he was going to be traveling and ministering to a few other message churches in the area, and what they have found out is as an effect of this mystery expo and the sovereign move of God that the message churches in the area are actually starting to come together and fellowship once again where they hadn't done so before. So that's a real wonderful testimony. And also he is going to be sending some other stable ministers to the area to continue the follow-ups and to continue to establish them in the word, and does ask for our prayers and our support if necessary. Here is the meeting. You see the picture there, Brother Danny. And here are some of the ministers that had showed up for that meeting. And there was four souls baptized. And they were pastors' children that were baptizers. Brother Danny praying with them, going out into the ocean there, and then baptizing them. And did want to also ask nicely if you would keep Brother Ron and I in prayer. We'll be leaving on Wednesday, and we'll be gone for almost 3 weeks. We'll be heading to the Philippines for about 8 days. Then after that, we'll be heading to Indonesia for the Pacific Asia Ministers Conference. So we really ask your prayers in that, and that Brother Nestor's going to do his very best to almost try to kill us. We'll be going to a new church every single day, it sounds like, from the itinerary. So we're going to need a lot of strength, if you don't mind. And we just go to be a blessing. We know we don't have much in regards to ability, but we have full confidence in the word, and we're going as living epistles to be read of all men. So we just ask that you keep that in prayer. We sure love you and thank you and appreciate your prayers for missions.
Come, thy fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me songs. Upon it, mouth of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the field of God. He to rescue me from danger, interposed his precious blood. Oh, the grace, how great a debtor, debtor. Daily I'm constrained to thee. Let thy grace, Lord, like a feather, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Amen. Praise God. Let's stand as Brother Chad prepares to come. Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise. For it was grace that bought my liberty. I do not know just why he came to love me so.
Be here again this morning. It's good to see all your faces, to worship together. Amen. It's good to be under the banner of the token of the blood of Jesus Christ and to know that we've got communion with them. I heard Joshua Goff when he prayed there opening up saying it's his spirit that makes the difference. It's his presence, his spirit. And the truth of that is, how do we know we have his spirit? And how do we know that it's the Spirit directing the church? Because you can't go by emotions, because you can find emotions in a lot of places. You can't go by feelings, because your feelings can fail you. You cannot even go by signs of healings. You cannot even go by signs of dancing in the Spirit. We know all those things can be imitated. So how is it that we know that it's a Spirit, that that's the feeling that we're feeling is a Spirit? Because he said, my words, they are Spirit and they are life. And with his word comes his spirit. And if you get his word, you get his spirit. Not an imposter spirit, not a lying spirit, not an imitating spirit, but the genuine Holy Spirit comes upon the genuine pure word. And so we know that this presence that we're in is his presence by what? By the revealing of the word. Without that word, we wouldn't know. And your feelings are not enough to go on to determine whether or not this is God. Amen. You can get good feelings at a concert. Amen. You can get really good feelings at a wedding. You can get good feelings in all kinds of places. But his word brings the life. how happy we are. Now when we glory in his presence, we know we're in his presence. And that's why there's freedom of worship, because we know we don't have to be restrained. We don't have to be careful. We don't have to be afraid. By the restoration of the word is the restoration of the life, and we're worshiping the true God, our Lord Jesus Christ. We're happy people. We should be the happiest people. God bless you, Brother Craig. It's good to see you and Sister Anna. He had a wedding he did yesterday in Logan, Ohio. So for him to be back up here, you guys have really been cruising the roads. It's good to see you guys. God bless you all. It's good to be here. Why don't we take our Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13. We'll go to verse 44. I just want to say, as we pray this morning, I'll be praying for Brother Emmanuel Sabas, who is preaching this morning over at Bible Believers. I had announced it several weeks back, and I got the date wrong. That was my fault, but it's today that he's over there, so we want to remember him in prayer. And also, Kyle mentioned to remember him and Brother Ron Garvin as they leave Wednesday. And at the end of service, I'd like to have them brothers come up, and if all the ministers will come and lay hands on them. And we want, as a body, to send them to the mission field with our full blessing and our full support. Also want to remind the Sunday school teachers, there's a meeting for all the Sunday school teachers immediately after service over in the offices. So if you'll remember that. Let's look today at Matthew chapter 13 and verse 44. Again, the kingdom of heaven is likened to treasure hid in a field, the which when a man hath found, he hideth, and for joy thereof goeth and selleth all that he hath, and buyeth that field. Let's just pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word. God, when we come to this part of the service, Lord, we know that it's by your ever-present way, Lord, your ability to bring a prophet on the scene and restore your word, Lord, that we can come knowing, Lord, that this is your word, and knowing what to do with this word and how to apply it and where to place it. And God, we just ask now that you would just take the man and move him to the side. But Lord, that the power of your Holy Ghost would operate, Lord, a gift that you've placed in this vessel of clay. And Lord, that we, your people, can feed on you, Lord. Feed on that hidden manna this morning, Lord. I pray that you would feed us. Break the bread of life to us. Lord, let your spirit flow and take preeminence and have dominion in this place. We ask in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. You all can be seated. Stay with this scripture. And keep your Bibles open. We're going to look at this again. And I spent a lot of time yesterday wrestling, which is kind of common for me sometimes on Saturday, because every direction that I thought I was going to go in, I hit a brick wall, I hit a dead end. And that may be hard to understand, but those who minister here will understand what that's like. You'll be trucking down the road, and all of a sudden, inspiration just nowhere. It's gone. And you know what? You cannot force inspiration. It's either there or it's not there. And when it's not there, it's like running through knee-deep water. You're getting nowhere fast and getting tired. So I tried another avenue, and the whole time, the subject is on the back part of my mind. And I keep pushing it off, and you'll find out in a minute why I'm pushing it off, thinking, no, it's not suitable, it wouldn't be good, and all this other stuff. And finally, you just submit, you just learn, and you think, you beat your head against the wall so many times, you think, eventually I'll stop doing this. And I'll just take that still small voice early instead of later. So I wrestled and wrestled all day. I walked miles around this parking lot yesterday, just wrestling with the Lord and asking for inspiration, crying. Because you know what? The worst thing in the world you can do is stand here as a man with no help from God and just look at God's people and say, what do you guys want to talk about? And so we need inspiration from God. And that's what we come for. You guys, I know, did not come to hear me or any other ministers stand here. You came to hear from the Lord. And that's what we want. So the reason that I wrestle and wrestled is because I want to preach on the masterpiece. And that's why I kept pushing it off, because Wednesday when I was driving up from Lexington, I got to listen to the second part of the masterpiece that Brother Craig had preached. And it was phenomenal, and it was outstanding, and it was excellent. And you know, when he was preaching, I was thinking, man, I wish I could preach like that. And that's what every preacher thinks when he hears somebody else preach. Man, I wish I could preach like that. But we know everybody has their place. And so this subject of the masterpiece, I was just going to hang it on the shelf because it was so thoroughly handled, but I just can't get away from it. So there's another angle that I want to take on that this morning. So just bear with me. If there's some overlap or repeat, well, it'll do us good. We've been reading the same Bible all our lives. You know, we have nothing new to bring. So I want to preach on the Smitten masterpiece this morning. So I want to look at this verse in Matthew 13 again, Matthew 13 and 44. It says, again, the kingdom of heaven is likened to a treasure hid in a field, the which when a man hath found, he hideth, and for joy thereof goeth and selleth all that he hath, and buyeth that field. So I want to break down this parable a little bit and show you what I believe this parable is referring to. If we go back to verse 37, and verse 37 is referring to an earlier parable that Jesus spoke of back in the previous part of the chapter, when he starts talking about there was a man went and sowed in a field, and an enemy came behind and sowed seed, and when they came up, they noticed there was tares with the wheat. And so here in verse 37, he's going to start to answer the symbology of that parable, and I want to take the symbology here and move it over to verse 44. So in 37, he answered and said unto them, he that soweth the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seed are the children of the kingdom. So here he says the field is the world. So that's our type. So when we come over here to 44, he said again, the kingdom of heaven is likened to treasure hid in a field. So the treasure is hid in the world, and this is the treasure of the kingdom of heaven. And so the treasure of the kingdom of heaven is hid in the world. Amen. And so then, when a man hath found, he hideth. And for joy thereof goeth and selleth all that he hath, and buyeth the field. So what happens now is the man in the world finds the treasure of the kingdom of heaven, and for joy he found that treasure, but he hid it back in the field again. He found the treasure and hid it back in the world, and he went and sold all that he had. Right? He selleth all that he hath and buyeth the field. He buyeth the world. What's he buying the world for? To get the treasure. Brother Branham says in the Sardisian Church Age, out of the Church Age book, therefore, as Paul says, if God should take of one lump of clay and make of the same lump one vessel unto honor and another vessel unto dishonor, who can be offended and cry against him? That he has the right to do this on the grounds of creation alone, we cannot deny. So he's saying God says, Paul says, he'll take of one lump of clay and make a vessel to honor, and another lump of clay and make a vessel to dishonor, and he has a right to because of creation. But he goes further here in the Sardisian Church Age. He says he has the right to do this on grounds of creation alone. We cannot deny. Yet he went even further, for according to Romans 14, 7-9, we have the irrefutable proof that Jesus paid the purchase price of the whole world. And therefore he can do as he wills with his own. That's why Jesus can sit on the throne at the white throne judgment and pass judgment righteously, because he owns it all. When he came and he went to the cross and he shed his blood upon the earth, with every drop of blood, he was purchasing back all of creation. Everything that's seen, everything in the heavens, the unseen, the seen, everything that was and is was purchased by Jesus Christ, and now he becomes the owner of all of creation, so he owns the world. And so now he can do with it as he wishes. If he wants to extend mercy to one group and allow them to come into eternal life at the white throne judgment, he can do so. If he looks at another group and says, because of what you've done, you must go to the lake of fire, he has the right to do so because he owns it all. Just like you can go to your closet and you can pull out one garment and you can decide to give this to Goodwill. You can take this other garment and pass it to somebody else, and you can take this garment and put it on. You have the right to do whatever you want with what you've purchased. And you're just, completely, totally just. You're just when you made the garments. You're just when you select where they'll go. You're just when you destroy one. You're just when you put one on. You're just because you created it, you purchased it, it's yours. So now God is just. So I want to show in this that Jesus Christ bought the field. Do we see that? He bought the field and he sold out everything. He gave his life. He died as a man. He went to the cross, was tortured, and he gave up his very life on this earth to purchase the whole field. And when he purchased the whole field, why did he purchase the field? Because he found in the field the treasure of the kingdom of heaven. But listen, he found it when he came on this earth. He found it. It came to him. It recognized him. But then he hid it. So where is the treasure of the kingdom of heaven? It's still hidden in the field. Nobody else knows where it's at. Everybody's looking and they see churches and they see denominations, the ecumenical movements, they see political systems. They have no idea where the treasure of the kingdom of heaven is, but the treasure is still hidden in the field. Amen. That's why we know this is speaking of Jesus Christ, because when you find the gospel, you don't hide it, you spread it. But Jesus Christ came to earth and he found the kingdom of heaven hidden in the field. And with joy, he sold out everything and he purchased the whole field. And he kept the treasure hidden. But the treasure can't always be hidden. It's hidden till a certain time. Brother Branham says in the message, "I am the resurrection and the life." He says, "But God sometimes trained men for years to get a few days of service out of him. John the Baptist was 30 years by himself in the wilderness for 6 months of service. Jesus Christ was 30 years old for 3 years of service for the crucifixion. God trains men, brings them up. It's his purpose." Listen, he says in the time is at hand in 1956, "And then came Jesus of Galilee to Jordan to be baptized of him, just an ordinary looking young fella of about 30 years old walking out into the water. All these years since the time of a child where the angels sang and the magi followed the star, and nothing had been said very much about him. He was the treasure. He was the gift that came to the earth, and there was an announcement of the gift, and there were signs in the heavens, and there was a stirring of the magi, and there was a stirring of the angels coming to the shepherds and the decree of shepherds. But then everything kind of went dormant. He took the gift and he kind of hid it, and he took it to Egypt and then took it up to Nazareth, and it was hidden until he was 30 years of age, and he brought him on the scene again, amen, to declare his treasure to the world, his gift. So nothing had been said very much about him, but when he was really to be the Son of God, the anointed Messiah, God gave him a sign out of heaven. That's when he came to the river." So we see here that God has this pattern, and in this pattern, he has the hidden treasure in the field. Jesus Christ was on this earth for 30 years, and he was hidden in the field. People walked by him, had no idea who he was. He might have got some basic education, and the kids in class next to him, they didn't know who he was. Amen? Some members in his own family didn't understand who he was. He was a treasure hidden in the field. And what was he doing with that treasure in the field? Let's turn to Hebrews chapter 5. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 7. "Who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save him from death, and was heard in that he feared. Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him." So we see here that though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. So this time that he spent as a treasure hidden in the field was not wasted time. This was time that the master sculptor was working out the last details of his picture, the last details of his masterpiece. Because when he came as a baby in a manger, he wasn't yet ready to be displayed to the world. He hid him back in the field. And while he was hidden in the field, he learned obedience by the things he suffered. And he was made perfect. Is that what the scriptures say? He was still in the studio. He was still with the master sculptor. And in the studio, the master sculptor was putting the final touches on this masterpiece. He had worked 4,000 years to bring to the headstone this masterpiece, all the way up to the head, starting on the pedestal of the patriarchs and coming through the prophets. And he said the prophets were the body word. Because the prophets are the word. They were the body coming up. And now they come to the head. And now the head is here. He comes as a baby in the manger. The head is here. But yet the head has to be perfected before it's on display to the world. So for 30 years, he's doing the final strokes, the final polishing, the final perfecting. Because when he gets this image done, it's going to be perfectly matching the image that he had in his head all along. We quite understand now, after we've been through the series, what Michelangelo's inspiration was for Moses, and how when he finally got to the place where what was in his mind was right before him, he was so inspired that he grabbed a hammer and he struck it on the knee and said, "Speak." And so God now is working the same kind of masterpiece. He's getting it perfect, the perfect image of what was in his mind, the perfect man, the last Adam, God himself in flesh, the word becoming a flesh body of a man, the full word on display as a man. And it's got to be perfected. And he was the full word when he was the baby in the manger. He was God made into flesh. That was the flesh of God. But yet that flesh of God had to go through a process of chiseling and refining until he was made perfect. He wasn't sin born. But yet he learned obedience by the things he suffered. And he was being made perfect. Let's look at Luke. Luke chapter 2 and verse 51. Luke 2 and 51. This is the story of Jesus when Jesus is left behind after the feast and his parents and his family go back to Nazareth, and he's in the temple and he's disputing with all the doctors of divinity, and his parents come back and find him. And in verse 51, "And he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was subject unto them. But his mother kept all these things saying, all these sayings in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man." So Jesus, the man, the flesh body of God, was going to increase in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and with man. So while we were in this period between the declaration of the head coming, which was the baby in the manger, and the masterpiece going on display for the whole world, he was a treasure hidden in the field. Rubbing shoulders with humanity, just another part of humanity, and nobody knew that this was the gift from heaven. This was the treasure of heaven standing there in flesh, and nobody knew it. What was God doing? God had him in the private studio finishing his work so that he could put his work on display. Brother Branham says in the Message of Prisoner in 1963, "God, before he could get the man in his hand, he had to strip him of his ambition. He had to strip him of his training." He's talking about Moses coming out of Egypt through the backside of the wilderness. And he said, "God, before he could get the man in his hand, he had to strip him of his ambition. He had to strip him of all his training. He did go out and he delivered. He killed one Egyptian. And he, when he did, he found out that he was in the wrong. He couldn't do that. It wasn't that way. And God had to take him out into the wilderness, into the desert, a desert place. You notice kind of strange how these fellows that God got a message for them, he takes them into a desert. He took Paul to a desert to train, to tell him what all this great vision was out in the desert. Go out to a certain desert, and he stayed there until God fully made known what to do. And so God now has this pattern where he takes his men, and there's a declaration that there's a gift in this man. This is a gift from heaven. But then they go back into the field and hide in the field. So there's a declaration, but then there's a hiding again. And Paul had a declaration. He was knocked off his horse. Brother Branham tells us he was knocked off his high horse. And he had met the pillar of fire. Agabus, a prophet, came and declared that you're going to do a service for the Lord. And it was all announced. And Paul was called out. And then Paul went into the desert of Arabia for 3.5 years. What was God doing? God had to get the picture right. He had to get the masterpiece right. He was knocking some theology off of Paul. He was knocking some harshness off of Paul. He had to get him to where he could take Paul and put his ministry before the people. So he took him on the backside of a desert and finished in his private studio the final strokes, the final polishing, the final bit of the masterpiece had to be finished. Moses was declared to be a deliverer. He got all the right training, all the perfection that a man could get if he wanted to be a military leader. He got it, but it wasn't God's training. That was not God's masterpiece. That was not God as a master sculptor creating Moses. That was the culture who created Moses. And God is not going to let the culture shape his masterpiece. He's not going to let the common thinking or the education system of the day shape his masterpiece, or the religion of the day shape his masterpiece, but he's going to shape it himself. So he lets Moses go off to try to be the deliverer. Moses fails, and he's get driven to the backside of the desert for 40 years so that God can shape his masterpiece his way, the way he wants him, not the way the previous 40 years had been done when he was in Egypt. So now we see this pattern over and over. We see it in Jesus Christ with the Magi and with the shepherds, and there's a declaration, but then there's a hiding back in the field until he's ready to present them. Paul, same way. Moses, the same way. And you and I, the same way. Brother Branham said, and Christ is revealed in his own word. He said, the thing that's the matter with the message today is that those who obtain it in their hearts must lay in the presence of the sun to get ripened. See, you can pick up the message and then let the sun bake all the greenness out of you, see? Make mature Christians. See what I mean? God is coming soon to receive his church, and we must have that type of Christians for him to receive. The wheat has got to get ripe. Now think of the analogies that Brother Branham uses here. He says, the wheat has come to the head, the life has come back to the seed again. And the evidence of that was there was a first part of that field that came to maturity, and the first part of that word that came to maturity was cut off and waved before the people through the ministry of William Branham. And it was a display of the Son of Man. The Son of Man was being waved, the Word was being waved over the people again. And what was that? It was the first part of the field to come to full harvest maturity, where all the greenness was baked out, where he'd come to the full life of Jesus Christ again in the stature of flesh, and it was waved over the people again. And it's showing that once the rest of the field gets to harvest maturity, then it's going to be the same thing. Whatever this was will be in the field, but it has to go through the maturing process. Even though the grains come to the head, it's still green, it still has moisture in it. So it's got to lay in the presence of the sun. Brother Branham says sun, S-O-N, to bake all that greenness out so it can come to harvest maturity. This happens in our personal lives, and it happens to the bride as a whole. Brother Branham says, and you must be born again in 1961. Born Christians grow into the stature of Christ as they live. They're born again and their lives begin to shape like a baby. Think about that. They're born again and their lives begin to shape up like a baby. It takes form and begins to grow. First thing you know, here they are in full stature. Brother Branham said, when you receive the Holy Ghost, you're a newborn babe. And you must grow. You must grow into maturity. When you receive the Holy Ghost, that's not the finishing. That's not when you're done maturing. When you receive the Holy Ghost, now you begin to mature in Christ. Before that, you weren't even in Christ. Being in Christ makes you perfect. Yes, you're perfect in him because he's perfect, but you have to mature. Amen. You're a newborn babe in Christ. You're born again. Born again. When you were born the first time, you didn't come out a full-grown human being. And when you're born the second time, it's the same way. You are perfect in Christ, but you must mature. Brother Branham said you're a newborn babe in Christ. You must grow. You must grow. Amen. So we see that Jesus went through this process. He was born. He was hid in the field. God was shaping him until he could bring him out and declare him to the world. I want to look at Isaiah 53 together, if we could go there, and we want to talk about the smitten masterpiece. Isaiah 53 and verse 1. Who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant and as a root out of dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he is wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. This is what happened when he came to perfection. This is the image of what happened to Christ when he came to perfection as Jesus Christ. When he got to the full stature of perfection, when he got to the image that was in God's mind after he built up over 4,000 years and he came to the image of what he had in the back part of his mind, this is what happened to that image. He said, we did esteem him, in verse 4, stricken, smitten of Rome, smitten of Caiaphas, smitten of the Jews. Who was it that smote him? Scripture says it was God. When he stood before Pilate, he says, you could do nothing if you did, you had no authority over me if it were not given to you of my Father. It was God who in his mind, when the image came to perfection, was so inspired that he struck it so that it could speak. Brother Branham talks about that in the message, The Masterpiece. 1964 says, so perfected a redeemer, a man so perfect, so godly, yet there was no beauty we should desire him. When this virgin-born Son of the living God became so perfect and humble in the image of God, until the great master who had brought his life up through the prophets, and he was the fulfilling of all the prophets, he was so perfect until God, seeing this, he smote him and has cried out, speak, as Michelangelo did, speak. You say, is that so? St. Mark 9:7, we find upon the Mount Transfiguration, when there stood Moses, the law, there stood Elijah, the prophets, all the way back from the patriarchs, the fathers, the law, the prophets, and all of them standing there. We hear a voice coming from the cloud and said, this is my beloved Son, hear ye him. And if they're going to hear, he's got to speak. It was just a few days before he was smitten. This is my Son, whom I pleased to dwell in. I have molded him. I've been 4,000 years bringing him to this, and now he is so perfect, I've got to smite him so he can speak. Hear ye him. He is the perfect one. He is the masterpiece. Remember, he was portrayed all the time back through the Old Testament. We find him being the rock in the wilderness that was smitten, the rock in the wilderness. And now, in order for this to speak, he is the Word. And for the Word to speak, he must come into an image. And then for the image to speak, it's got to be smitten. Look at this pattern. For it to speak, if it's going to speak, it's got to be the Word. Because the Word is the spoken Word of God. If it's going to speak, it's got to be the Word. And so if it's going to speak, being the Word, he must come into an image. And for the image to speak, it must be smitten. We got that pattern. If it's going to speak, it first must be the Word. Nothing can speak outside of the Word. And for the Word to speak, it's got to come into an image. And for the image to speak, it has to be smitten. Further in the masterpiece, he says, as it taken him 4,000 years to make this masterpiece, now he's been for nearly 2,000 years making another masterpiece, a bride for Christ, another masterpiece. In so doing it, he does it by his never-changing method, the same way he made the masterpiece, his Word. That's the way he makes his masterpieces, because he can only be a perfect masterpiece when it's the perfect Word. That's why denominations can't produce a bride. It's not a perfect Word. That's why there had to be a prophet come on the scene to produce a perfect Word bride, because there has to be a perfect Word to present another masterpiece. And we know the masterpiece isn't Christ alone, and the masterpiece isn't the bride alone, but the masterpiece is the masterpiece family. The image God had in his mind when he said, I'll create man in my image and my likeness, I'll create them, and he made them male and female. That was what was in his mind. The masterpiece was male. Out of male comes female. United back together is the masterpiece. Guess what? That's the story of the whole Bible. The entire Bible, we just said in those few sentences right there, that's the whole thing. That masterpiece was marred, and now the whole Bible is the record of him bringing it back to that original thought. A man, out of the man comes the woman, united together as one. That's the masterpiece. That's the whole Bible. That's the whole story of redemption. This is a book of redemption. And that's the story of redemption. That's the plan of redemption, to get Christ and a many-membered bride back into Eden again. Hallelujah. Oh, it's so simple, you can teach it to Sunday school children. And then everything else in between. You know, you find that same image in Genesis 1, you find it in Revelations 22, the first chapter of the Bible and the last chapter of the Bible. I wasn't going to do this, but let's do it because it's fun. Genesis chapter 1, let's go together. Genesis chapter 1, verse 27. So God created man in his own image, and the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. Genesis 1. So what we see there is the image of God, and the image of God is the oneness of the male and the female together as one. Let's go to Revelations 22, the last chapter of the Bible. Don't you love how the redemption story goes in a full circle? Everything Brother Bram said begins in Genesis. Genesis is the seed book of the whole Bible. And everything that begins in Genesis winds up in Revelations. Either in the new heavens or the lake of fire. It's going to go to one place or the other. Revelations 22, verse 1. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. And in the midst of the street of it, on either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Now, we've preached on this before when we preached the tree of life, but I just want to go through this again. It says there's a river of life, a crystal, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, on either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bore 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit or his fruit? Her fruit. The tree of life yielded her fruit. Isn't that interesting? And so we look at this scripture and we see here, it says the tree of life, one tree of life. And so we know there is only one tree of life. How many agrees? But it says on either side of the river stood the tree of life. So there's a river of life flowing, and on this side of the river is the tree of life, and over on this side of the river is the tree of life. In human perspective, it looks like two trees. You would look and say there's two trees. You see two trunks and you see leaves, and you say there's two trees, but the Bible said that's one tree. Just like when you would look in the Garden of Eden, you would see a man and you would see a woman and you would say, there's two, but God called their name Adam. God saw one. You see two. I with my eyes see two, but the faith seed inside of me looks and says, that's one. Adam and Eve, the man and woman, united together as one flesh, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. That's one. And he called their name Adam. Eve did not get her name till after she separated from Adam and fell in adultery. Her name was Adam. His name was Adam because the two were one in the eyes of God. And so now we get to the river of life, and on either side there stands a tree. And from human perspective, you'll say there's two trees. That's why Brother Branham said there's those two trees of life restored back again. But they're one tree. In the root is one tree. The roots spread out to two stalks. Then the leaves grow back together over top. And what you have is one tree of life. From the root, it's one. It comes out separate, and then it gets united back together again. Genesis 1, Revelations 22, the whole story of redemption. And guess what? Out of this tree, the root ball coming together, two two trunks coming up together, then the leaves growing back together again, because it grows up the Christ tree, it grows up the bride tree, and the last day to be united together again, mingled back together. And what comes out of the middle of that? The river of life. That's why it's a tree of life. That's why the bride of Jesus Christ, united to Jesus Christ in this day, is giving out of her belly flows the waters of living waters. Where else are you going to go to get living waters? You got to go to the tree of life, where Christ and his bride have been united together again, and out of their bellies will flow rivers of living water. Genesis 1, Revelations 22, showing the same picture. Aren't you glad you have eyes to see and ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches in this day? How many sees yourself in Revelations 22? Hallelujah. It's so good. I just love it. So he says in the masterpiece again, as it taken him 4,000 years to make this masterpiece, now he's been for nearly 2,000 years making another masterpiece, a bride for Christ, another masterpiece. And so doing it, he does it by his never-changing method, the same way he made the masterpiece, the Word. And that's the way he makes this masterpiece. Because it's got to be a perfect masterpiece by a perfect word. He goes on to say, further in the masterpiece, to be his bride, you must be part of him. Not part of the creed, not part of the church, not part of the denomination, but part of him. Hewed out of any other kind of form won't work. You've got to be hewed from the word. The word, the world cut off of you, and you just leave the world, word only, live in you. So what's he saying? He takes this piece of marble and he begins to knock stuff off of the marble. The image is inside the marble. But he's got to get stuff away from the image. So what's in God's mind? He's got to knock stuff away from it so that what's in there can be expressed. And he does the same thing in the lives of you and I. We come to the Lord, amen, we receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and he starts chiseling and knocking and beating on us, because why? There's an image of Jesus Christ trapped inside you and I. There's an image of the perfect word, the perfect bride word trapped in you and I, but he's got to knock pieces of the world off so that the only thing that's left in you and I is the word. And he says he's got to be hewed from the word. The world cut off of you, and just leave the word only live in you. The great sculptor is counting on you, willing to stand and have yourself shaped into the likeness of his requirements that his word requires. He said the sculptor is depending on you to stand and let the word cut all that's not the word off of you. Amen. How does he do it? It's, you know, I get so, I said this last week, I don't know what day, Wednesday or something, but I said there's no fairy tales in this religion. There's so much fairy tales in Christianity, like God will sprinkle fairy dust on you and poof, things will change. That's not how God does it. If you look in the scriptures, he's always had a method, and his method was always his word, and his word always came by his prophets. And that's how he shaped Israel into a nation. How did he knock all of Egypt off of Israel? He sent a prophet with the word, and he gave the law, and the law was there to make an image in Israel. So how were they shaped? By the word. Amen. And so now we've got to come into the image of Jesus Christ. We've got to be shaped into the image that was in the mind of God. How are we going to be shaped? He's got to do it the same way. He's got to bring his word through a prophet, and those words, when they're received, will knock the world off of you, and you'll come to the image of Jesus Christ. So much of this stuff is in our minds. We think, well, you know, God will do it, like he'll sprinkle dust on us someday, and poof, there'll be a change. He does it by his word. And you have to accept his word, and we have to submit to his word. And when we submit to his word, he's knocking the world off. When we come to him and say, Lord, I can't make that part of your word live, but I believe it. Would you make it live in me? And the sculptor will come by with his little hammer and tink, 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 pow, it'll fall off. But not if we don't recognize the word. Not if we don't receive the word in its purity, in the format which he gave it, then we'll just stand there an incomplete work. Because how does he cut it? By his word. How does he shape it? By his word. Because in you is attributes of God. In you is an image to Jesus Christ in the form of the bride. And he's got to knock things off of there that don't belong. Old habits and things that we learn and previous understandings of Scripture. He's got to knock those things off so that what's left behind is the image of Jesus Christ in the form of his bride. Hallelujah. He's depending on us to submit to that. And things that are to be, Brother Branham says, therefore we must be that word bride. And what is the word bride? Good question. The manifestation of this hour. What is that word bride? The manifestation of this hour, the bride. Not a creed or a denomination, but a living oracle of God, a living attribute of God, displayed to the world the attributes of God in the formation of the bride that's to be expressed in this hour that we're now living. Now that bride has to come to full maturity. Just like Jesus had to come to full maturity. Just like Moses had to come to full maturity. Just like Paul had to come to full maturity. It's got to come to full maturity. And we can look back over 50 years and scratch our head and say, what's been happening for 50 years? The prophet come on the scene. He declared that there's a bride coming forth. He was in Eliezer ministry calling out a Rebecca. But Brother Branham tells us that this bride now has to lay in the presence of the sun to bake all the greenness out. He's telling us that she's now standing on her feet, but she's got to grow into maturity because Jesus Christ is not coming back for a little girl. He's coming back for a full-grown bride. And so this bride has to go through a maturing process. And so we can look back and say, well, this is 50 years that's been wasted. What do you mean wasted? Look at the maturity to the word that's come in the bride. Look at the understanding of what the prophet was teaching us now versus 10 years ago or 15 years ago. I would never want to go back 1 year. How many of you would want to go back to your revelation of the message 1 year? No way. What's he doing? He's continually unveiling himself. He's bringing more maturity and more maturity and more maturity, and he's shaping the stone and shaping the stone. And now this is image is coming up just like Jesus Christ, hidden in the world, hidden in a field. But there's coming a time when he's going to keep working and working and working and working until he's done working. And then when he's done working, he's going to show it off to the whole world. How many's getting ready for that day? In the sculptor's shed, in the studio, hidden in the field. This bride is still hidden in the field. And he's working on her, and he's shaping her. She's learning obedience by the things she suffers. She's growing in wisdom and in stature with God and with man. Doing the same thing he did to Jesus Christ when he first came. The prophet came just like the magi came and said, this is him. The prophet came just like the shepherds came and said, this is him. And the prophet came and said, this is her. The capstone's come. We've come to the capstone of the church. Christ himself returning to the church. And now she was birthed as a bride. And now she's had to mature. I was talking to Brother Nestor, and he gave me a perspective that was very, very unique to the message. And we were talking about the generations that have been before, you know, through the 70s and through the 80s and through the 90s. And Brother Nestor remembers much of that. And we know that our understanding has increased, that our revelation has increased, and the image has had to have increased. But you look back and you say, what was going on there? And Brother Nestor says, you got to remember, he says, that bride was just born. And so God was bringing ministry along that would protect the little virgin girl as she became a teenager. And he said, so the early ministry was very strict, right? And so the early ministry was very strict because she hadn't come to maturity yet. She had to keep him. He had to keep him close. Had to keep the world away. Had to keep churches, false churches away and false understanding away. And she had to come to maturity. And so there was a strictness to the message, and the strictness was there to protect the virgin. Because when you have daughters, we raise our daughters so that our daughters can eventually be independent and self-thinking and self-sustaining. But when your daughters are babies, You buy all their clothes, and you put all their clothes on them. Then they get a little older, and you buy all their clothes, and then you pick out their outfits, and they put it on themselves. Then you buy all their clothes, and you let them pick which outfit they're going to put on themselves, until eventually they come to a maturity that they can go to the store and pick out their own clothes. That's maturity. When they start off, you don't take your 2-year-old and say, "What do you want to wear?" You don't take your 13-year-old and say, "What do you want to wear?" You have to get them to a stage where they develop into maturity. Now they can make godly choices about clothes they put on. They make the choices. They dress themselves. When they come to be young ladies in their late teens and early 20s, they should be able, if they had the right kind of training and they love God, they should be able to go pick out their own clothes. Amen? And the same thing's true with the bride. When she first comes out, she's got to be told what to wear, what to do, where to go, not to go. But as she matures, this bride is moving to a place where she's got discernment and she knows how to dress herself. That's why we don't preach every sermon on how to dress and not cut your hair, because we've moved to a different level of maturity, because the bride now knows how to get her clothes and how to put them on. How to wear her hair. It doesn't mean everybody's at the same level. We'll go back and readdress it. But that's why the ministry has been changing over time. Why? The bride is maturing. And as the bride matures, she now goes from milk to meat. She doesn't want to hear every Sunday about how long her skirt should be. If we haven't got it by now, we're in trouble. Doesn't want to hear every Sunday. Yes, we'll preach it. Brother Brennan said, if you don't preach clothesline, you're not preaching the gospel. We'll preach it for those new babes that are coming up. But the bride as a whole doesn't need to hear that. What she needs is to know who she is. She needs somebody to tell her who she is and what she's doing and where she's going. She's at a different level of maturity. When you take your daughter and you begin to prepare for a marriage, you now say you're a marriage age. You're going to be united to this man. Let me give you instructions for marriage. Let me give you instructions for keeping your own home. You shouldn't be telling her how to wear all her clothes and what clothes to pick out. You should be giving her instructions for her future life. And now we've come to the place where the bride is getting instructions for her future life. She's getting instructions for the millennial reign. She's getting instructions for the showdown that's coming. Because she's come to a different level of maturity. And that's why I will never criticize the previous generations. Never. Never say, well, that ministry was too hard and it was too critical. God was protecting the virgin. God has control. God knows what he's doing. I'll never criticize the previous because we're standing on their shoulders. If there hadn't been ministers and churches and believers battling it out through the 70s and through the 80s and the 90s, we wouldn't be here today. How dare us look back and say they were too this and they were too that. They were exactly what the bride needed at the time. And now what are we today? Too soft and too that. We're exactly what the bride needs today. Not every minister, not, you know what I'm talking about, the bride as a whole, the ministry is shifting to bring the meat that she needs for today. Not milk. Not milk on outward appearance, that's milk. But meat on what is life all about. Who am I really? Who is my Savior? Who is my bridegroom? What's it gonna be like? That's where we've come to. And I am thankful. And once you get a taste of meat, who wants milk? Now milk is just something you take on the side to wash down your meat. It's not the main course anymore. Amen. We've come to the main course. We've come to the meat, and that's what we hunger for. We want it. So now this bride, she was announced. She was declared. There were signs in the heavens. There was a great display, and then it went hush. And for 50 years, she's been the treasure of heaven, hidden in the field. What's God been doing? Finishing the polishing up of his bride. Finishing the last few strokes. Brushing the dust off. Rubbing there and rubbing there and getting out the rubbing compound. What's he doing? He's getting her ready. What's he getting her ready for? To go on display. Brother Branham said in the masterpiece, Malachi 4 is to bring back to the original. She is smitten from the church body, smitten with her master for the same purpose. She is the word. Now you get that. He said this first masterpiece was smitten by the sculptor. And now, unlike Michelangelo, when he knocked a piece off, he just knocked a piece off and it was gone. But now the Lord himself has knocked a piece off, and out of that piece, he made now the second part of the masterpiece. And now the second part of the masterpiece has to be smitten like the first part was smitten. That's what he's saying. Smitten with her master for the same purpose. She is the word, just the same as Joseph was smitten from his brethren because he was the word. And Jesus was smitten from his brethren because he was the word. The church is smitten. The bride is smitten from the church because she is the word. Not because she preaches the word, not because she knows the word, not because she declares the word, because she is the word. Oh, our minds have to shift. You're not preaching the word. You're not sharing the word. You are the word. You're not becoming the bride. You are the bride. Brother Branham looked down in the seals and he said, I no longer call you church. I call you bride. There was a prophet declaring that this people on this earth, this hidden treasure hidden in the field, is the bride of Jesus Christ. And now that bride has been in the studio, hidden in the field, polishing up. She's not becoming the bride. She already is the bride. The bride is smitten from the church because she is the word. The Bible bride, smitten and afflicted of God. Listen to this. Remember Isaiah 53, smitten and afflicted of God. What was Isaiah 53 talking about? Jesus Christ. We esteemed him. We did esteem no beauty that we should behold him. We did esteem him smitten, stricken, smitten of God, right? Now look at what Brother Branham's going to do with that verse. The Bible bride, smitten and afflicted of God. Smitten and afflicted of the World Council of Churches? Smitten and afflicted of false doctrine? Smitten and afflicted of the government? No. Smitten and afflicted of God. No beauty we should desire her. But yet we did esteem her smitten and afflicted of God. That's right. Brother Branham is taking the scripture that applies to Jesus Christ in his first coming, and he is taking it and applying it to the bride. He's changing him and he to her and she. And guess what? He can do it. And he's correct. And he's not wrong. And he's not misquoting the word. Amen. Amen. Is he misquoting the word? Is he getting it wrong? Is he messing up the scriptures? But yet we did esteem her smitten and afflicted of God. That's right. She stands alone. She is smitten from all the denominations according to Revelation 3. She is smitten out of the Laodicean church age that she was raised up in. Romans 8:17 said, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. I want to look at another scripture that it looks like Brother Branham is going to misquote. And the truth of the matter is, he's not misquoting scripture. He's placing the scripture. He's giving the further revelation of the word. So let's go to Genesis chapter 3 together. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 14. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all the cattle and above every beast of the field, and upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. So we know that scripture. I want to read that scripture, and then I want to listen to something Brother Branham said. In the Message of Grace, 1961, he said, "The woman's seed shall bruise the serpent's head, the guilty one, and his head shall bruise her heel." What did Genesis 3 say? That you'll bruise his heel. But now Brother Branham is saying, "And his head shall bruise her heel." Is he denying that Jesus' heel was bruised? Absolutely not, it was. But what he's telling us is he's saying everything that happened to Christ has to happen to the bride. She's part of him. She's come out of him. She's a further expression of him. She is the Word, and what happens to the Word in male happens to the Word in female. So there's an application for us too. Now listen, "The woman's seed shall bruise the serpent's head, the guilty one, and his head shall bruise her heel." And Brother Bram says this over and over. This isn't one time, multiple times. He said he'll bruise her heel. "His head shall bruise her heel," to show there'd be an affliction to the church. But he promised a triumph. Satan, the seed of the woman, will bruise Satan's head, the serpent's head, and he shall bruise her heel, to show that there is an affliction coming to the church. But he promised triumph. Will the bride of Jesus Christ go through the tribulation? Absolutely not. Is there an affliction coming to her? Absolutely. Will her heel be bruised? You betcha. That's what he says. In the masterpiece, I might have already read this, maybe not. In the masterpiece, we believe the bride is getting its last polishing down. Who believes that? Amen. The bride is getting its last polishing down. It'll be smitten from the complete organization altogether, and then the great harvest will be here. Yes. See, Brother Bram says this over and over again. Something has to happen. Amen. There's something more that has to happen. We're not going to remain like this and all of a sudden we all disappear. There has to come an affliction to the church. There has to be a bruising of her heel. There has to be a smiting from all the organizations, and then the harvest will come. Why? Because the harvest cycle has to be complete. And the harvest cycle being complete, you don't take wheat from the field and take it to the garner. You can't do that. You have to take wheat. Amen? And in Jesus' day, when the Bible days, when they're talking about harvesting wheat, they didn't have a combine. So they would cut the wheat and they would bring it to the threshing floor. And when they got it to the threshing floor, then they would beat it and flail it and walk on it with oxen and roll over it with stones. And what are they doing? The affliction. They had a flail. A flail was a rod with a leather strap to another stick like this. And they would beat the wheat. Why is the farmer beating the wheat? Does he hate it? That's his whole substance. That's his whole living. That's the whole reason he planted the field, was to get this wheat on the threshing floor. And so now his love for the wheat, his desire for the wheat, has him beating the wheat. Because what's he doing? He is separating the chaff. He's separating the husk. He's separating the dirt. He's separating it from the wheat. And then you know the scripture, it says John the Baptist, speaking of Christ, he said his fan is in his hand and he'll thoroughly purge his threshing floor. That word fan is not a fan like this. That's what I used to think. I looked it up because it didn't make any sense to me. But it's a winnowing fork. When after they would flail and beat the wheat and with the husk and the stalk and all of it together, he would scoop it with this winnowing fork and throw it in the air on a windy day. And let the winds of tribulation, let the winds of persecution blow all the chaff away, blow all the dirt away, blow all the husk and stalk away. And guess what happened to the wheat? The wheat was made in such a way that no matter how high you tossed it, and no matter how much the wind was blowing, it would land back in the threshing floor. And when it got back to the threshing floor, they would beat it again. And beat it again, and beat it again, not because of hate, not because of anger, but because of love for the value of the wheat. What was the wheat? It was a treasure hid in a field. And now he gets to the place, it's time to take the treasure out of the field. It's time to take it to the garner, take the treasure. When the man comes to the earth, he finds the field, and in the field is the treasure. That's Jesus Christ. He selleth all that he has to buy the field. But there's coming a day he's going to take the treasure out of the field, which is the world, and he's going to bring it to himself. And now what's the farmer doing? He's taking the treasure that's in his field, and he's bringing it to himself. But the process is threshing. And he'll keep beating it and keep tossing it and beating it and tossing it until what? Until there's no unbelief left on the threshing floor. Till the only thing on the threshing floor is wheat and wheat only. And when he gets it to that stage, then it goes to the gardener. Every type, every display we have in the Word, everything that Brother Branham told us, we're not going from here to the gardener. There has to be a threshing floor for this bride. There has to be an affliction to the bride. There has to be a smiting. The first image was smitten, so it would speak. The second image will be smitten. Why? So she can speak. Not to each other, not to one person in the cubicle next to you, but there's going to come a time when Brother Branham said that this earth will hear directly from God as they did at Pentecost. How did they do at Pentecost? They ran into the street on a feast day when all Israel was gathered together, and they went like drunken men, speaking in tongues and shouting and gathering a great crowd out in the streets. Gathering huge crowds to proclaim what had been done. What was that? They were hearing directly from God. And this generation will hear directly from God again, as they did at the day of Pentecost. So we want to get back to where Brother Ben says, now his head shall bruise her heel. We've come to the head of everything. Brother Branham said this light, the light of the gospel that's shining, it's bringing every seed that's in the field to full harvest maturity. Everything is maturing under the gospel. When you watch politics, what are you seeing? The full maturity of the wheat, of the weeds. The weeds that have been laying there, the tares and the weeds and the thistles and the thorns that have been there all along, now they're coming to full maturity. And now you can see what it is. It's amazing how some people talk about this election and that election. I love this election. I love this election. Because it's everything the prophet told us about America. It says she's rotten to the core. She's rotten on the inside. She's no good. I don't even pray for her. Is that what the prophet of God told us? He told us that inside this tree called America was rotten all through the inside. And one day this thing's going to fall over and you're going to see it's hollow inside. Guess what we're watching? God now, you know, more news comes out, and the next day more horrible news comes out, and it gets worse and it gets worse, and it's criminal and it's vile and it's ungodly. Oh, I love it, because God always takes what's under the surface and brings it to the surface. You just give him enough time, God will always take what's laying under in your life, my life, in the church, in the world, and he'll always put it on display. That's what's happening right now. All the dirt and filth and trash and ungodliness and wretchedness of this nation is now on public display for the whole world to see. The best two candidates that we can produce as a nation are a perfect picture of what is in the heart of America. You want to see what America is? Look at the two candidates that are put on display. That is America. That's why I'm so glad I'm not an American. I'm a Christian that lives in America. I'm so thankful that I'm part of another kingdom, another political system, where there's a king, the son of David, is going to sit on that throne, and I get to rule and reign with him for 1,000 years in a righteous kingdom. This whole world is shaking to pieces. This whole world is falling apart. There's nothing left. Everything has come to fullness. Satan's Eden come to fullness. The bride of Jesus Christ, the word coming to fullness. It's all coming to fullness under what? Under the ministry of Malachi 4. What did it come for? To bring back a light. There shall be light in the evening time. What's the evening time light doing? Bringing everything to full maturity. And we see it all. It's all right before us. It's beautiful. It means it's time for us to go home. It means we thought the last 8 years brought changes. Oh my goodness, just wait. More changes are coming. We think, oh, this smiting from the organizations, all this persecution, it's got to go way down the road. It could turn on a dime. Everything's set up. Everything's in order. It could turn so fast it'll make your head spin. And I'm looking forward to it. Not that we go out and make ourselves awed, not that we go down and start beating tambourines in people's faces and yelling and screaming up and down the road. We got to move by the Spirit of God. We got to move by permission. He said, this bride, she'll have thus saith the Lord, or she'll keep still. We're not going to produce persecution by acting like a bunch of nuts. But the word being manifest in due season makes you oddballs. Makes you a nut. Brother Branham said, don't forget the nuts hold the whole thing together. You take the nuts out, you got a pile of junk. And guess what happens when these nuts leave this earth? There's nothing left but a pile of junk for tribulation. You're the one holding the whole thing together. You're the one holding back atomic bombs. You are. Your presence on this earth, by the baptism of the Holy Ghost, being in a people, is holding back waves of tribulation. That's why the whole system is built to get you out of the way. Amen. Because you're stopping the progress of Satan's Eden. You're stopping the destruction of the human race. You're stopping tribulation from setting in because you're here. And so Satan's building a system to get you out of the way. The whole system is built to take you off the scene. The whole ecumenical system, the whole World Council of Churches, this whole beast system that's coming together is coming to get you off the scene, to shut you up. My brother Branham said, they'll never shut her up, she'll be taken up. Nothing's going to shut us up because we're not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it's the power of God unto salvation, and it doesn't exist anywhere else outside of this bride. She's got the gospel of salvation. She's not afraid to boldly proclaim it. Hallelujah. So now he says he'll bruise her heel. Let's turn to Romans 16. I love how scriptural the prophet of God is. Whenever you read something that Brother Branham says and he's preaching doctrine and he hits it several times and your brain goes, what? You rest assured there's something marvelous there. Romans chapter 16, verse 20. And the God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. And the God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet surely. I thought it was under his feet. The seed of the woman shall bruise your head and you'll bruise his heel. Paul is telling us God shall bruise Satan's head under your feet. Why? Because the seed of the woman is back in the bride again. He's here in the form of the bride. It's him. We are his body, and he's putting all things under his feet. Where are his feet? Are you his body? Are you the literal body of Jesus Christ? Then all things have to be put under his feet. And if they're put under his feet, that means they're automatically put under your feet. Because now he's living, working, and moving through a bride. And so now he is going to bruise Satan's head under your feet. It's still the seed of the woman. It's still him bruising his head, but he's doing it with you. You're the vessel he's using. You're the feet. You're the body. You're the mouth. You're the eyes. You're the one who's wrecking the devil's kingdom. You're the one that he's got to get out of the way because you're ruining the whole plan. It's you. Why? Because we're powerful people? No, because we know a powerful word. And all we have to do is say what the word says. And oh, it makes the devil tremble, makes him cringe. It makes him so angry. Why? Because we know the truth. And we won't be deceived. We won't go into the system. And we won't shut up about it. If we would just shut up about it, it would be okay. He wouldn't mind so bad. But the problem is there's coming a boldness in the bride. For 50 years, we've labored and labored with this word, and it's been more real and more real and more real, and it's been attacked and criticized and scorned. And every time it's attacked, he raises up a greater understanding. And the more it's attacked, he raises up a greater understanding, until now what we have now is so much more than what we had before. Oh, I'm saying attack it again. Please, there's more I want unlocked. I want to see more of the word. Because you can't kill this thing. Amen. You burn it, all you do is refine it. You beat it, all you do is get the impurities out of it, because this is gold that comes from the throne of God. This is Jesus Christ himself. You can't burn it or beat it into submission. Every time you burn it or beat it, it gets more pure, more valuable, more precious. Hallelujah. Is that what's happened to the word in your life? Is it more precious? When somebody's attacked it and tried to take it down and criticize it and say it's not true, what's happened? It's more precious. It's more valuable than it was before. It means more to me than it did 4 years ago. Hallelujah. And God, the God of peace, shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. I like that. I don't have to do it. I don't have to figure out how. God will do it. How will he do it? He'll do it with his masterpiece. Just like he's always done it. He's done it with his masterpiece. And now he's going to do it with his masterpiece. I just want to go to Revelations chapter 1. Verse 12. John heard a voice, and when he turned, in Revelations 1 and 12, said, I turned to see the voice that spake with me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. Now, we all know what seven golden candlesticks are. They represent the seven church ages. And in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. So when he turns and he sees the church, in the middle of the church, that's what mist means. In the middle of the church is the Son of Man. Where's the Son of Man at? In the church. When did John see the Son of Man in the church? When it was time for the revelation of Jesus Christ. When he saw when it came time for the revelation of Jesus Christ, he turned and he could see now where Christ has been all along. Where has this Son of Man been? In the church. When? In all seven. Now we've come to the time of all seven being declared, of the fullness being understood. And when the church comes to fullness, all seven, right in their midst is the Son of Man. We've come to the fullness of all seven with an understanding of what they are. We've come to the peak now, and in the midst of the church is the Son of Man. Look at this. He had a cloth with a garment down to the foot and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. The paps are the breasts, and he's girt about the breasts and shoulders. Brother Branham said, showing that now the girdle moved from a priest girdle to a judge girdle. But it's amazing that paps are mentioned, and every time this word is mentioned, it's always referring to women, never to men. It can be used for men, but never anywhere in the New Testament is paps used for men. It's used for women. Because he's in the midst of his church. Christ in the form of his bride. What do you think we're going to be doing when we sit on the throne with him at the white throne judgment? Twiddling our thumbs? Know you not that you shall judge the earth? 14, his head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet like unto fine brass, if they were burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. Brother Branham said, many waters, many peoples, nations, tongues. It's in Revelation 17. And he said, so his voice was the sound of many waters. What is his voice? His voice is the sound of the many-membered bride. His voice is the sound of the church from every nation, tongue, kindred, and nation. And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. So now at the end of the church ages, when we see him standing in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks, now he's dressed about the paps, not the waist, with a golden girdle. Feet like brass, because he's put all things under his feet, and brass symbolizes judgment. Hair white as wool, because he's come as supreme deity, judge of all the earth. Where? In his church, now he returns as judge, not lamb, judge. That's why when he came in 1963 and he had the sign of the cloud, he said, look at the white-wigged one. It's the judge. He's come as the judge. Where? Where did he go? I hate fairy tale religion. I like a reality. When he came, he's not walking around on the earth in some invisible form. He went into the treasure, hid in the field. Where is that gift from heaven? Where is that treasure of heaven? That treasure of the kingdom of heaven is hidden in the field. The Son of Man in the midst of his church as a judge. Remember, it was the judge who avenged the woman who came to him many times. Judges aren't just here to put you in prison. They're also here to set you free. The same judge that can condemn you is the same judge that can exonerate you. And now where is that judge? In his bride. That's why she has to be smitten. Brother Branham said in the Laodicean Church Age, out of the Church Age book, now I said a moment ago that the false vine came into full fruition in this age. Her fruit would mature and ripen. That is correct. This evil-spirited church full of iniquity will be revealed as the mustard seed that grew into a tree wherein lodge the fowls of the air. At her head will be the Antichrist, the mystery of iniquity. All this is true, and if this is true, then it must also be true that the bride church will mature, and her ripeness shall be the identification with her Lord by means of the word. Did you catch that? The church, the bride church will mature, and her ripeness shall be an identification with her Lord by means of the word. How can you tell she's mature? Because she takes the word. She accepts the word. She knows the word. That's the identification with her Lord. That's how she's identified with Jesus Christ, is by the word. Not because all of a sudden there'll be a glow about you and there'll be a halo that comes over your head. No, you're identified that you're with the Lord because of the word. Remember, it's so simple. How do we know that this is the Spirit of God? Because the Spirit comes with the word. My words are spirit and life. How do we know Jesus? This is Jesus Christ? Because Jesus Christ is the word. How we know this is the bride? Because she's taking the word. So simple. I think sometimes I feel like that I'm looking for something to happen, and it's happening every day, and I'm missing it. It's happening every church service. It's every time I listen to a tape, every time I read a book, it's happening. He's shaping the masterpiece. I'm receiving the word. The Spirit of God is here. Life is here. I'm receiving life. I'm receiving His Spirit, and I'm waiting for something to happen. We're missing it, brothers and sisters. It's happening. He's here in the midst of His church. He is the judge. He's here to set free. He's here to condemn. Why? Because she has the word. She is the voice of many waters. If you recognize, when Jesus went to speak, he spoke as a voice with many waters. It wasn't one clear sounding. It was the many-membered bride speaking. Praise the Lord. In her head, who will come to her is the mystery of godliness, which indeed is Christ. And as the false church with all cunning and diabolical power made up of political force, physical force, and demons of darkness come against this true vine, remember, she has to be smitten. Remember, he will bruise her heel. So when this false church with all cunning and diabolical power made up of political force, physical force, demons of darkness, come against this true vine. Have they come against you yet? Has it come against you yet? Have they moved in to shut us up yet? This is coming. To come against this true vine, the true vine with the fullness of the Spirit and the Word will do the very acts of power that Jesus did. Nothing to be afraid of, brothers and sisters. It's all under control. He's already got a plan, and the plan's inside of you, and the plan's in the Word, and He's working His plan right now. You know, they've told stories, and I've heard stories over and over and over of great physical feats of people who were in dire situations. Right, a car would fall on a son, and a mother would lift the car, and the son would crawl out. And the lady say, how you do it? I don't know. But when the need was there, there was an ability. And we're coming to a time where there'll be a need, and the need will bring out the ability that's already there. The need will bring out the very nature of Jesus Christ, the very power of the gospel. When? When there's a need. Not to show off, not to clown before people, not so that we can feel better about ourselves. We know who we are by the Word. That's our identification. We don't need a sign. We don't need a pillar of fire. We don't need that to identify ourselves as the bride. We've got the open book. I love pillars of fire. I wouldn't be unhappy if they showed up and danced around the church, but we're not looking for that to have faith in who we are. We're not looking that for an identification. We're already identified. We're already called out. We've already been declared. We know who we are. We don't need one sign. I don't need to speak in tongues. I don't need to be slain in the Spirit. I don't need those things to believe. I already believe. Why? By the open book, by the Word. That's my identification. So God is not doing these things to clown. He's not doing these things to give you a confirmation. His Word is confirmation enough. He wants a bride, a Word bride, and a Word bride accepts the Word. He doesn't want a sensation bride, amen? He doesn't want a tongues bride. He doesn't even want a healing bride where we have to have healing and then we feel like God knows us and loves us because He healed us. God heals people that aren't His. God healed a tremendous amount of people that would later spit in His face and reject the message. Think about the thousands and thousands of people that were healed in Brother Branham's ministry, and then they would turn and reject William Branham and call it blasphemy and heresy. Healing is no sign that He loves you and you're His. Sensations are no sign. What's the sign? I'm identified by the Word. The Word is my sign. The Word is my vindication. The Word is my confirmation. And inside of me, there's a faith that believes it. Inside of me, there's something that identifies with it. The Word in me and the Word that's come have connected, and they're one and the same. And I know it. I know it. How do you know it? I don't know. I know it. Show it to me. I can't. But what's coming through the message and what's in me is the same thing. I hear it, I may have never heard it before, but when I hear it, I say, that's the truth. The preacher can come and he can be preaching something that we've never heard before, and you hear it and you say, that's the truth, because inside something says, yes, that's got to be it. That's what I am, that's what I feel, that's what I know. So God is not going to produce great signs and wonders so that you can feel better about who you are, so you and I can finally rest in the fact that, oh, I am His. When there's a need, the need will bring out the virtue. Just like the little mother when her son gets trapped under a car, she has strength that's far beyond her normal ability. The need creates the strength. The need draws out what that human body is actually capable of doing. And she reaches down and she lifts the car, and the little son crawls out, runs into a fire, would have never run into a fire before. A timid man or a timid woman who would never have been a hero when there was a need became a hero. Then ask her, they say, well, how did you do that? I have no idea. What was it? It was the need. And there's going to come a time, there's going to be a need for the full display of the full power of Jesus Christ. And when there's a need, guess what it's going to draw? It's going to draw virtue that's already in you. It's not going to come to you, it's already there. That power, that manifestation, that declaration is already in the bride. We're not waiting for anything else to come, it's come. but the need will pull it out. When you have a need for healing, when healing is needful in your life, when there's conditions in your body, then all of a sudden faith comes for healing. Amen. When you need deliverance in your life, now all of a sudden faith comes for deliverance. You wouldn't have had faith before, but you have faith when there's a need for it, because the condition draws the virtue out. And all the virtue of Jesus Christ, by his word, is in the bride, and now he's going to draw it out for a display. Don't forget, she's the judge. In the Laodicean church age, he says, yes, sir, the church is no longer the mouthpiece of God. It is its own mouthpiece. So God is turning on her and will confound her through the prophet and the bride. For the voice of God will be in her. The voice of many waters. Yes, it is, for it says that in the last chapter of Revelation, verse 17, the Spirit and the bride say, come. Once more, the world will hear direct from God as at Pentecost. Do you believe that? How? Through your mouth, through your life, through the manifestation coming through your flesh, they will hear direct from God as at Pentecost. But of course, that word bride will be repudiated as in the first age. Further in the Laodicean church, he says, you listen to the authenticated prophet of God who appears in this last age. What he says from God, the bride will say. The Spirit and the prophet and the bride will say the same thing. How many is not ashamed to say what the prophet said? Oh, sometimes it sounds offensive, but it can be no more offensive than Jesus Christ when he says, unless you drink my blood and eat my flesh, you have no part with me. What do you think it sounded like in church that day? What do you think people were looking at each other thinking, will you tell me what he said? I think I missed it. They get out after church and they're talking to each other. Did he say we have to drink his blood and eat his flesh? Then they looked at him, each other, and they said, this is a hard saying. And they left him. He turned to disciples. He said, will you go also? He didn't say, please don't go. He let the word do the separating. All he did was speak the truth. He didn't have to explain it. He said it. And Peter says, where are we going to go? Thou alone have the words of eternal life. The prophet says some stuff. It's hard to understand. But I believe we're understanding it better now than we were 5 years ago. I believe the picture's coming more clear now than it used to be. Gives us courage to hang on for the rest of it. But what happened to us when those things were challenged? What happens to us when we don't understand? We say, where else are we going to go? Thou alone have the words of eternal life. There's no place else to go. I can go with the ministerial association and say, this is a hard saying. It was an offensive saying. It was hard to be understood, and he didn't explain it, but the seed said, it's true. How's it work? I don't know how it works, but it's true. And later at the communion table, he revealed to them at the Last Supper what he was talking about. We're not afraid to say what the prophet said. For the Spirit and the prophet and the bride will be saying the same thing. And what they will say will have already been said in the Word. You know, just like when Brother Branham says, he shall bruise her heel. You can say, that's not what the scripture says. Until you go to Romans, and Paul says he's going to bruise Satan under your feet shortly. Then all of a sudden, those two scriptures come right together. And then you realize, the prophet knew exactly what he was saying. He said it correctly. It looked like misquoting scripture, but it was the perfect quotation and placing of the scripture. Sometimes we just got to hold on and forget our own thinking. Take the word. He said, no, what they will say will have already been said in the word. They are saying it now. Come out from among her now and be ye separate. The cry has gone out. The cry is going out. How long will the voice cry? We do not know. But one thing we do know, it won't be long, for this is the last age. What will they be saying? Come out from among her now and be ye separate. Why do you think the beast system will rise up to shut up the bride? What's she saying? Come out from among her now and be separate. Come out of this thing. This is death. This is not life. This is not the gospel. This is not Christianity. This is not the word of God. That's what she'll be saying. Come out from this system. Come out from these churches. Come out from this Catholic system. Come out from your Methodist. Come out from your Baptist. Come out from your Presbyterian. Come out from your interdenominational. Come out from those. That's what she's going to be saying. That's why the whole church systems will hate her. Because she has the words of eternal life. She has truth. And she's saying what the scriptures say. She's saying the spirit and the prophet and the bride will be saying the same thing. What are they saying? Come out from among her and be ye separate. We all know where that comes from. That comes from Revelations 18. And when you go to Revelations 18, I've said this before, but I just want to emphasize this. When you go there and you read those, when you read that same phrase, come out from among her, it says, a voice from heaven said. Yeah. A voice from heaven said, come out from among her. What voice is in the bride? A voice from heaven. They will hear directly from God as they did at Pentecost. What will they be hearing? Come out from among her and be ye separate. What is that? That is a voice from heaven. How do you hear the voice from heaven? It's coming through the many waters. It's coming through the voice of many waters. Through the bride now is taking a scripture in Revelations 18 and they are fleshing it out in the day that they live. And what is it? It's a voice from heaven. And a sound of many waters. That's our job. That is our decree. That is for us to do. Brother Branham says in the Pergamene church age, I've said some of these before, some of this is review, but I just in this context of the Smitten masterpiece, I want to lay this in. He said, those in the bride do only his will. No one can make them do otherwise. They have thus saith the Lord, and they keep still. They know that it has to be God in them doing the works. Got that? It has to be God in them doing the works, fulfilling his own word. He did not complete all his work while in his earthly ministry, so now he works in and through the bride. She knows that, for it was not yet time for him to do certain things that he must now do. But he will now fulfill through the bride that work which he left for this specific time. How's he going to do it? In the midst of the churches, in the midst of the bride. He's coming in the form of a bride, and he's doing his work. Amen. He says, and the world is falling apart. The church is ready. She's sealed in, ready to come. There will be a big outpouring of the Spirit, yes, sir, to grab that church and take her into the skies. Amen. Hallelujah. Exactly, because see, the church, the word, the bride, and Christ, his ministry is in the bride, which is his body. His ministry is in the bride. When he comes as judge, where's that ministry? In the bride. When he comes to save, where's that ministry? In the bride. When he comes to heal, where's that ministry? In the bride. His ministry is in the bride. Matthew 18:11 says, the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. If his ministry is in the bride, and this is the Son of Man ministry in a many-membered bride. What's his ministry? To seek and to save that which is lost. That's why we're crying, come out from among her and be ye separate. We're not crying it to the walls. We're not crying it just to be heard. We're crying it because there's those that can come out and be separate. Because when the Son of Man was here, he came to seek and to save that which was lost. Brother Branham says in the identified masterpiece of God, there's where he became the masterpiece for us. Just remember, all masterpieces, before they can ever be put in the Hall of Fame, they have to go through their Hall of Critics first. The critics has to be see if they can criticize it, but when it stands the critics, then it took to the Hall of Fame. God's Son passed through the critics of every organization, denomination, even till Pilate said, I find no fault in him. Judas said, I betrayed innocent blood. And then God raised him up, and he hangs in the great Hall of Fame today. at the right hand of God making intercession. Don't you want to join him there? Don't you want to be part of that? You can be. You're invited to be. How many wants to be part of that? He says in the masterpiece, Michelangelo could not produce that again. He could not put the part back that he broke off. He said, but God is going to do it. He is going to bring this little bride that's smitten right back to the side of the original word. And there he is. And there's the masterpiece, the family, back again in the Garden of Eden. Michelangelo, when he knocked it off, it just knocked off. When God smote Jesus Christ, out of him came the ingredients to make the second masterpiece. And now, like the Chinese laundry tag, Brother Branham tells us about when the Chinamen come and they did the laundry, he said he couldn't read or write English, so he tore the tag. And where the tag was tore, you get a half, he gets a half. And when you come back together to redeem what's yours, you've got to put the two together. They got to match up perfectly. And now what was smitten off of Jesus Christ has formed into the bride of Jesus Christ. And now those two tags have come together and they've got to match up perfectly. What are they making? They're making one whole unit again, soon to be delivered back into Eden. Michelangelo couldn't put it together again. God's going to. God's doing it now. He's knitting the two together as one, and very soon they'll be the one together in flesh when we meet in the air. John chapter 8. We'll read this as we close. Musicians, if you want to come on up, let's read this last verse together. John chapter 8. John chapter 8, verse 58. Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. And they took up stones to cast at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by. See, Jesus was standing there telling them the truth, and they didn't like it. They took up stones to stone him. But he hid himself and passed through. He was there, but he was hidden because it wasn't yet time. There came a time when he would hide himself no more. And what time was it when he decided he would not hide himself anymore? Because we see he had the ability to hide himself. He was there present, but hidden. He was there among them, but they couldn't see him. He was telling the truth, but then he could go back into hiding. He could declare something, then hide. But there came a time when he wasn't going to hide anymore, and the time that he would no longer use his power to hide himself, when it was time for the masterpiece to be smitten. And now in this bride masterpiece, this second part of the masterpiece family, Jesus is hiding himself. He's right here. He's right among them, but they can't see. He's right in their midst. He's saying things like, before Abraham was, I am. He's saying things like, there's not three gods, there's one. And then hiding. He's saying things like, you can't marry and divorce and marry and divorce and marry and divorce. And then he's hiding. But there's going to come a time when Jesus will not hide himself anymore. And when it's time for the second masterpiece to be smitten, he will no longer be in hiding, but he'll be in full display. And when he's in full display, it's time for the smiting of the masterpiece. Because when it's smitten, it's time to speak. Yes. Brothers and sisters, there's nothing going to shut us down. There's nothing going to shut us up. There's nothing going to take us off the scene. When that pressure comes, when that squeeze comes down, when that tightening comes up, it's time to speak. Because the masterpiece will be smitten so that he can say, hear ye him. What is it? The voice of many waters. Jesus Christ, the judge, girt about the paps with gold, the white-haired wigged one, the feet of brass. Where? In the church. And there's coming a time when he'll refuse to hide himself anymore. And there's coming a time where he's going to take the treasure out of the field. And all the world will see. They won't want his treasure any more than they wanted Jesus Christ when he was here in flesh. But he will lift her up just the same for the world to see. And all the power will be manifest in her that was manifest in Jesus Christ. And then she'll go to glory. What a glorious time for this bride of Jesus Christ. When there's a need, there's attributes to come forth. When there's a pressure, there's Christ to be displayed. None of these things that we speak of should frighten anybody. This is a glorious day. This is a beautiful day. When Jesus was taken captive, there was nothing to be afraid of. All that God had planned was coming to pass. It was a beautiful day for the church. It was a glorious day for redemption. It was a wonderful time for the seed of God. And when this pressure comes down upon the church, when he comes to smite her, remember, she's smitten and afflicted of God. God is not smiting and afflicting her because he hates her any more than the farmer is threshing his wheat, but God is bringing a total separation from unbelief. God is separating out his wheat completely unto himself, and then he's showing the treasure that was hid in the field. And then we go to be forever with the Lord, to be forever by his side, to come back in the millennial reign. Let's all stand. How many is happy just to be a Christian? So excited for what God has showed us. I read a news article yesterday where Russia was voted off of the Human Rights Council in the UN. You think they're going to like that? You think that makes Putin happy? Why? Because they didn't like what he's doing in Syria. And so now the world's trying to punish him. And what's happening? World War III lines are being drawn. They're being divided. This is how the war started before. If you don't remember, go back and read all the political things that were moving years before war broke out in World War II. And now the United Nations would not even, Russia could not even garner enough votes to remain on the Human Rights Council. And now they've been kicked off the Human Rights Council. It's a beautiful day. It's a beautiful day. Dividing lines. There was a top government official in Russia said, you better vote for Donald Trump unless you want World War III. Who read that article? An aide to Putin, so I think as a cabinet member or somebody in Congress, said, because if you get Hillary Clinton, you're going to have World War III. She's going to be smitten. And when she's smitten, she'll speak. And it'll be the voice of many waters. And it'll be Jesus Christ. And this world will hear again directly from heaven, directly from God. And what will they be saying? Come out from this system. Come out from this world. Come out from all of this and be ye separated unto God. I am so excited to live this day. That attribute of God that's down inside of you, thirst and longs for the manifestation of Jesus Christ in this day. You would have been totally unsatisfied in another day. It's this day. It's this hour. It's this time. What is it going to be? It's going to be a housewife with the boldness of a lion to say what the prophet said. It's going to be a teenager with the boldness of a lion. The scriptures and proverbs say the righteous are as bold as a lion. Not fearful, but it's going to be a mama. It's going to be a child. It's going to be a daddy. It's going to be somebody who is not afraid to say what the prophet said, to say what the scriptures say, to call black, black, and white, white, and this system exactly what it is. Systems of man that bring death. You think they'll love you for it? The seed of God will. Somebody told you. Somebody told me. And I came out and have now been separated. I want to tell somebody else. This is the hour I was born for. This is the moment you were born for. Before the foundation of the world, when God was allotting portions of himself to be manifest in different ages, he reserved this certain type of attribute for this day. He was holding it back. He said, no, that part of my seed, it's got to be reserved for the blackest of black. It's got to be reserved for the darkest of dark. How do you know you'll overcome? Because that part of you that's in you now was in Jesus Christ when he faced the same thing on this earthly journey. You were in him walking the earth. You were in him facing the Pharisees. You were in him when he stood up in the day of the feast and said, come unto me, all that are thirsty. You were there. What's going to give you the ability to do it now? You've already done it once. It's just a repeat. And now that part of you was the declaring in the final hours of Jesus Christ have come now to declare the final hours of the bride of Jesus Christ. Fearless by the grace of God. Powerful by the power of His Spirit. Untouchable by the Word. I'm excited. You know, Israel, before they go into battle, they sing and dance. Going in the battle, knowing some of their friends might come back, knowing they're going to fight, might give their lives, they sing and dance for the victory before. And I'm ready to sing and dance for the victory before, because He's showing there'll be an affliction come to the bride. There'll be an affliction come to the bride when He bruises her heel. But He's promised triumph. Before it even starts, I'm willing to praise Him for the victory. Amen. How many want to praise Him for the victory? If we could sing that song, I Keep Listening for a Different Sound. How many starting to hear a different sound? Sounds a little different, doesn't it? Amen.
Hear about the wars, see famine in the land. There's questions in the children's eyes, trouble in the east again. Oh, the whole world is screaming. There's no place to stand, and mournful sounds are heard throughout the land. But I keep listening for a different sound, sound of pity that John saw coming down, the sound of the bride being united with the groom. I keep listening, I keep listening, I keep listening for a different sound. I remember the preacher saying, son, it shall come to pass. There will be a generation that will be the last. I can't believe we're standing here, seeing the end of time, and the preacher's voice echoing in my mind. But I keep listening for a different sound, the sound of the city that John saw coming down, the sound of the bride being united with the groom. I keep listening, I keep listening, I keep listening for a different sound.
Brothers and sisters, if we could only peek a little bit of time in advance and see what's going to happen, we would be in such a hurry to get there. We would be racing for it, because I feel the magnet pulling me. I can feel it rising up. I know it's there. Something's just around the bend. Something's just in another turn of the road, and we're watching it, and I'm excited for it. You mothers, don't be afraid for your babies. Your babies will have the faith of God. You children, don't be worried. You may not make it to fifth grade. You may not get your driver's license, but when that time comes for that showdown, you won't care. You'll be so happy, so excited, it won't matter. Don't you let the devil put thoughts in your head. There's nothing to be afraid of. There'll be children rise up with the boldness of a lion. There'll be youth that'll take this word and they'll say it with no fear. No fear. Not because we're powerful, not because we're mighty, but because we've got the Word, and the Word has never failed. The Word is everything, brothers and sisters. That's why the Word had to be restored. It's all in the Word. Jesus Christ was the Word. The Word was God. You're part of the Word. Are you going to burn the Word? Are you going to imprison it? How are you going to hold it down? Nothing's going to stop the Word from being made manifest. Nothing to fear, only excitement. Oh, I thank God Brothers, minister, brothers, if you'll come, we want to pray for Brother Ron. Brother Ron, if you'll come, Brother Kyle, if you'll come down. We just want to lay hands on these brothers, and we want to send them as an assembly, that they go with our blessings, they go with our prayers. Brother Bob, if you'll come, all the ministers, if you'll come. Amen. Brother Mike, Brother Benjamin, anybody else, if I missed you, you know who you are, just come on. How many will be praying for these brothers? They leave out Wednesday, they'll be gone 18 days. And remember their families too. This is a sacrifice, not just for them, not for us, but for their families. It's a great sacrifice. So pray for them. Come up here, brothers. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we come together as an assembly of believers, Lord. And you've knit our hearts together. We've come together to worship you, Lord. But our desire is to see this gospel go forth in purity, Lord, in clarity, to call out the last predestinated seed, to encourage the saints, to encourage the believers in foreign lands. I pray that you'd be with my brother Kyle, my brother Ron, Lord, as we send them off from us. I pray that you'd hover about them, put a hedge of protection about them, Lord, that your spirit would be mighty on their behalf, that you would move through them, that you'd put words in their mouth, that you would minister through them, that you would encourage through them, Lord. God, and I pray that they'd go representing this body of believers as our faith goes with them, Lord. We hold them before you. We ask that you would pave the way ahead of them, Lord, and that you would set their feet down in your perfect will in the center of your road. God, we pray that you would hedge about their families and protect them, Lord, as they're gone. That there'd be blessings heaped upon their wives, Lord, leaped upon their children as they're gone. And that you, Lord, would restore them back to us and back to their families. We ask for these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. God bless you, brothers. Thank you. Praise the Lord. That's what we're here for. To be the voice of many waters. To go, to send others, to pray for, to send books to support missionaries, to witness to those around us, bring them into the church. That's what we're here for. To get the word to the seed. Oh, I'm so thankful. When I think about what I'm thankful for, it's just overwhelming. If God could come to you now and say, would you like to have lived in Wesley's day? Or would you like to have been on Azusa Street at the outpouring of the gifts? I say, no way. Leave me right here. Leave me in Satan's Eden. Leave me in the world that's falling apart. Leave me in earthquakes and volcanoes and war and pestilence and famine. Leave me right here. Because I was born for this hour. What's in me, what's in me and what's boiling up in me and what God's bringing to the service was what he designed to overcome this day. If God gave me a choice, I'd say, God, let me stay right here, right now. I wouldn't miss this for the world. Oh, praise God. You think Paul would have missed his day? Persecutions, chased from city to city, stoned and shipwrecked and lied about. He would have never missed his day. Because what he was seeing was Christ coming up. And here in Thessalonica, in Corinth, in Athens, he was watching it happen all around him. He would have never missed it for anything in the world. And I would never miss this for anything in the world. I thank God he's allowed me to be here in this day. I thank God he's allowed me to be with you, my brothers and sisters, in this family of God. Oh, I thank God. Let's pray for our brothers. Brother Craig will be leaving early December also, so remember that trip. We have a few weeks before that happens. But God bless you, saints. We'll dismiss you with a song. It's been good to be with you today. We love you all. Let's sing this again, Brother Tommy.
I keep listening for a different sound. The sound of the city that John saw coming down. The sound of the bride being united with the groom. Listening for a different sound. Yes, I remember the preacher say, son, it shall come to pass. There will be a generation that will be the last. I can't believe we're standing here, seeing the end of time, and the preacher's voice echoing in my mind. But I keep listening for a different sound, sound of the city that John saw coming down. I keep listening for a different sound. Amen. Ready to leave in the twinkling of an eye. Oh, we're making investments in the bank up in the sky. Oh, happy preparation, not a reason to grieve. Oh, are you in that number getting ready to leave? Folks are building hopes down here and planning ahead. They're so busy with their fortune they forgot what Jesus said about the wars and earthquakes and the victories budding leaves. But there's a group of people getting ready to leave. Oh, ready to leave in the twinkling of an eye. Making investments in the bank up in the sky. Happy preparation's not a reason to grieve. Are you in that number getting ready to leave? What's the reason for your needless delay? While you're hesitating, Christ could come most any day. Just make your way to Calvary, and get in that number, getting ready to leave. Oh, ready to leave in the twinkling of an eye. Making investments in the bank up in the sky. Happy preparation, not a reason to grieve. Are you in that number getting ready to leave? Ready to leave in the twinkling of an eye. Making investments in the bank up in the sky. Happy preparation, what a getting ready to leave. You're going to be a meeting in the air, in the sweet, sweet by and by. Oh, I am going to meet you and greet you over there, in that home beyond the sky. Such singing you will hear, never heard by mortal ear. Yes, I do declare. And God's own Son will be the leading one at that meeting in the air. There is going to be a meeting in the air, in the sweet, sweet by and by. I am going to meet you and greet you over there, in that home beyond the sky. Such singing you will hear, never heard by mortal ear. It'll be glorious, I do declare. And God's own Son will be that leading one in that meeting in the air. Sing that first verse. You have heard of little Moses in the bulrush. You have heard of fearless David and his sling. And you have heard the story told of dreaming Joseph, and of Jonah and the whale you often sing. Oh, there are many, many others in the Bible, and I should like to meet them all, I do declare. By and by the Lord will surely let us meet them. sweet, sweet by and by. I am going to meet you and greet you over there in that home beyond the sky. Oh, such singing you will hear, never heard by mortal ear. It'll be glorious, I do declare. And God's own Son will be the leading one at that meeting in the air. It's a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb. It's a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb. It's a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb. It's a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb.